Welcome to my show. Friends, today I have for you a book titled The Indian Mutiny of 1857, authored by George Bruce Mallison. Friend, it's a book of some 278 pages published by Rupa Publications, who have done a good job. The price of this book is rupees 278, and it happens to be the fifth print or impression of this particular book that came out in 2016. Mallison lived from 8th of May 1825 to 1st March 1898. He was an officer born in Wimbledon and educated at Winchester. Thereafter, he obtained the cadetship in the Bengal Infantry in 1842 and served through the Second Burmese War. He was a prolific writer. He had written extensively on the Sepoy Mutiny. His important works include History of the Indian Mutiny of 1857-1858, that runs into six volumes, and this is part of that. History of the French in India and the Decisive Battles of India. He even authored the biographies of the Mughal Emperor Akbar, the French Governor General Dupleix, and the British officer Robert Clive for the Rulers of India series. He died in London on 1st March 1898. Friends, the mutiny of 1857 remains an event shrouded in mystery and intrigue. Its very significance whether it can be considered as the first war of independence continues to be questioned. The causes of the mutiny are many, but all elusive, and so are the consequences of the mutiny. But the moot point is, did the mutiny ring the death toll of the British Empire, or was it a mere speck of exaggerated trouble? The book takes you through that. Out here, I would also like to say, even Jallianwala Bagh is considered an event that pushed the British Empire totally back. The book serves to fill a tremendous gap in narrative accounts of the mutiny and demystifies lay assumptions. It begins with a sizable background on the genesis of the British Raj in India, a move not deliberate but powerful enough to shape history for decades to come. The author delves in great detail into the causes of the mutiny, unlike preceding writers who mostly concentrated on the consequences. And this the author could do because he was a serving officer himself and was privy to many decisions and happenings. With the aid of personal knowledge and observation, he attempts to pinpoint the latent power that drove the mutiny on. He provides a realistic account of all the important operations that took place, praising the heroic and criticizing the undeserving. He is careful not to overlay his work with too much tedious detail, where his writing remains lucid and interesting. The Indian Mutiny of 1857 captures successfully and even uncompromisingly an event that was perhaps disorganized but large in scale. It deals with each individual and geographical area separately, analyzing the causes and the effects both locally and even nationwide. It captures the spirit of the time, its people who fought and died, and the changing attitudes of the British Raj, which was gradually losing control of its empire. In writing this short history of the Indian Mutiny of 1857, the author has aimed at the compilation of a work which, when complete in itself, should narrate the causes as well as the consequences of the movement, unforeseen and undreamt of. Sudden and swift in its action, and which taxed the utmost the energies of the British people. So even if the Britishers did not say anything about it or did not talk much about it, within the confines this particular mutiny had really sapped the Britishers. Preceding writers on the same subject, whilst dealing very amply with the consequences, have, with one exception, but deeply shadowed forth the causes. The very actors in the mutiny failed to detect them. What the author is essentially trying to say is that although many of these authors have written books about the mutiny, but they are not very clear about the causes. Most of them have gone towards the final result or the consequences. Sir John Lawrence, the then Viceroy of India from 1864 to 1869, he himself has written a book and has full knowledge of events in which he played a very conspicuous part, mistook the instruments for the chief cause. He stopped at the greased cartridge. Now we all know that the mutiny started because of the greased cartridge in which there was animal lard. So he stopped at the greased cartridge, but the greased cartridge was never issued to the great body of the troops, if indeed to anyone. So as per the author, that probably was not the main cause, because the greased cartridge was not issued to the entire troop. There must have been a latent motive power to make off an unused cartridge a grievance so terrible as to rouse into revolting men whose fathers and whose father's father had contributed in making of the British Empire in India. The grease cartridge too did not concern those landowners and cultivators of Awadh and the northwestern provinces who rose almost to a man. What that latent motive power was, the author has described fully in this particular volume. In the early chapters of the book, the author communicates that his belief about the mutiny is founded on personal knowledge and personal observation. Locally, chief of commissariat department at Kanpur, when in January 1856, Sir James Outram crossed the Ganges to depose or remove from office the King of Awadh, I witnessed the indignation which the very rumor of his purpose caused among the Sipahis of my own guard. So essentially, when Outram had come to depose or remove the Mughal king, at that time only there was a great amount of distrust that had seeped in to all these sepoys. So the author says, I reported their excited state to my superiors and was laughed at for my pains, but impressed with the accuracy of my forecast that the visualizing that the annexation of Awadh would rouse indignation and anger in the Sipahi army. I continued then, and after my transfer 2 months later to an appointment in the military audit department in Calcutta to keep a careful record of several occurrences, all apparently of minor import, which supervened when the effects of the annexation of Awadh had been thoroughly realized by the Sipahis. My observation led to the conclusion that they were thoroughly angered, and a little later that their minds were being mysteriously worked upon. I kept copious notes about all this, of all these matters. I observed and discussed them with my brother officers without finding that my views were shared by any of them. Essentially, it was not alone the grease cartridge, but a host of other reasons that brought about the mutiny of 1857. It would seem, however, that the officer who held the responsible post of town major, his name was Major Orful Cavanagh, had, from his own observation, arrived at conclusions not dissimilar. He has narrated in his admirable work the observations forced upon him by the changed demeanor of the natives of the northwest provinces in 1856. But he too stood amongst high places, high placed Europeans, almost alone in his convictions. The fact is, before I go forward, I would like to say that there were some officers in the British Raj who wanted to tell the real story, the real feelings of the Indian people to the higher ups, but these guys who were holding the high positions never listened to these officers. The fact is that up to the very outbreak of the mutiny at Meerut, which is present-day Meerut, no one from the highest to the lowest believed in the possibility of a general combination. Those, and they could be counted on the fingers, I mean, those who believe could be counted on fingers of one hand, who endeavored to hint at an opposite conclusion, were ridiculed as alarmists. So anybody trying to say that the Indians are unhappy and there's likely to be a revolt, the British British Raj officers, the top people thought he's an alarmist. So ingrained was the belief in the loyalty of the Sipais, and so profound was the ignorance as to the manner in which their minds were affected, that neither the outbreak at Meerut nor seizure of Delhi entirely removed it. So this was a big misconception, friends, that the top British officials had, that ye hamara gulam hai, the Sipai is my gulam. So they always believed in that, and that is why this mutiny came up, and when it came up, they were taken by surprise. The book is divided into 28 chapters that begins with the introduction and then talks about the conspirators to the first mutterings of the storm and the happenings at Barakpur, Calcutta and the Northwest. The revolt at Meerut, present-day Meerut, is significant along with the seizure of Delhi. The effect of the seizure of Delhi across India is described quite well. The author then goes on to describe the progress of the insurrection in the Northwest. There are several other chapters as a spillover of the mutiny that leads to march, that leads to the march to Delhi, and the author has listed the reasons and activities that flared up in Kanpur, Lucknow, Allahabad, Calcutta. It also describes in great detail the Britishers taking back famous monuments from the mutineers, such as the residency of Lucknow after Havelock's first attempts to relieve it failed. The other places that the book covers are the events in Sagar and Narmada territories, Central India, Rajputana, the Meerut districts, Rohilkhand and the Punjab province, and even Gwalior. It then talks of the second attempt to take over Lucknow residency and the Gwalior contingent. It also describes how Sir Colin Campbell recovers the Doab area of Punjab. The book also covers the rebellion in eastern Bengal, eastern Bihar and Azamgarh and Allahabad and eastern Awadh. The author has used the names of the cities and places as they were written in those days. The book impacts you only if you've read it in a continuous stretch. It brings you to a point where you start thinking that sure enough the mutiny of 1857 must have been a forerunner to the fight for freedom in India that the Indians launched against the British Raj in the 20th century under Mahatma Gandhi. Overall, the book is a treat for history lovers. It is meticulously punctuated and therefore the style of writing automatically changes. And so you might take a few more hours or even days to complete the book as compared to some other present day book of same number, same amount of pages. I would give the book 7 out of 10, a must read for history lovers. So friends, that's all I have for today. If you like my show, kindly share it. Also press the like icon. Also subscribe our channel by pressing the red icon. And don't forget to press the bell so that you are notified each time we upload a video. And for now, goodbye and see you soon.